Let's continue our analysis of the feedforward filter that we were discussing a couple of videos back. We had subjected the filter to a few different test signals. Signals of particular frequencies, like 0 Hz, the Nyquist, the half Nyquist, and the quarter Nyquist frequencies. The last test signal left for us is the impulse signal. We learned from the last video that the impulse signal has a very unique property, that it contains sinusoids of all possible frequencies, from 0 Hz all the way up to the Nyquist frequency. Now that we have a better understanding of what an impulse signal is, let's pass it through the filter and get an impulse response. Here, we have our first order feedforward filter, with the coefficients of A0 and A1 as 0.5. The first sample that enters is 1, which is the impulse itself. So using the difference equation, the output signal is just the direct sample, whose value is 1, weighted by the coefficient of A0, which is 0.5, added to the delayed sample that was previously in the register. Now, since this is the very first pass through the filter, there was nothing that was previously in the register. In this case, a default state of 0 is passed. This value is multiplied by the coefficient A1, and hence the resulting output value is 0.5. So for the first input sample of 1, the output sample is 0.5. Now we need to update the state of the delay register with the value that was passed. So we set the state of the register to 1. Next, in the input series, we have 0. So calculating the difference equation again, the direct path is 0 times 0.5, and in the delayed path, the previous state was 1, so the delayed path results in 0.5. The output is 0.5. Let's update the state of the register again, and this time it's 0. Next pass, and all passes after that, we have 0. So the direct path remains the same, which is 0, and in the delayed path, the previous state was 0, and so the result is 0. The output of the difference equation is 0, and we update the register value to 0. After this sample, every other sample would yield the same result of output equal to 0, since the input signal doesn't alter. So for an input sequence of the impulse, we get an impulse response which looks like this. Since there are a finite number of non-zero values that we get in the impulse response, in this case it's only 2, this is regarded as a finite impulse response, or FIR. In general, all filters, which are purely feed-forward in their topology, have a finite impulse response, and they're said to be stable. We can see that the impulse is flattened and smeared out. It also looks like 2 points on a sink-like function. Another interesting and bizarre observation that you might make is that the 2 non-zero values are identical to our pair of filter coefficients, A0 and A1. This is not a coincidence. For a feed-forward type filter, the non-zero values of the impulse response are identical to the filter coefficients. The more you think about it, the more it makes sense. The impulse input is always a single sample of 1. And this sample is solely influenced by the coefficients A0 and A1. So they would directly have an effect on the output samples produced. Here's what an impulse response would look like for coefficients of 0.75 and -0.25. The non-zero sample values of the finite impulse response would take after the values of the coefficients. Let's look at some programmatic examples of this. I'll run Python on Jupyter Notebooks, and you can get the code online in the description below. I've got a feedforward filter function defined here, and this function accepts 3 arguments. X, which is the input signal, and A0 and A1, which are the filter coefficients. The function basically loops through the entire range of the input and calculates the output by using this difference equation, and then returns the output. All we're doing here is creating an impulse signal, feeding that impulse signal through the feedforward filter function, and getting the impulse response out, and then plotting both the impulse and the impulse response on 2 separate graphs. When A0 and A1 are 0.5 each, we see a familiar response in the impulse signal. If you change A0 to be 0.75 and A1 to be -0.25, then we can see that the non-zero values of the impulse response are identical to the coefficients that we chose. So, the impulse response is the time domain response of the filter. There isn't much we can infer from this graph, other than the fact that the signal has been slightly stretched out and smeared. The real interesting part is how the filter behaves with certain frequencies. And for this, we need a frequency domain representation of the impulse response. Fortunately, this is quite easy to do. Once we have the time domain response, we can convert that into a frequency domain response by using the FFT, or the Fast Fourier Transforms algorithm. So I'm going to calculate the FFT spectrum of the impulse response. The result from the FFT operation is a bunch of complex numbers. The absolute value of the complex numbers gives us the magnitude of the frequencies, or the amplitude of the frequencies. And the angle value gives us the phase of the different frequencies. So I can plot both the frequency response and the phase response. So if we filter the impulse signal through the first order feedforward filter with the coefficients of A0 and A1 as 0.5 each, we get the following graphs. On the left is the frequency response graph, and this is more like it. This gives us a lot of valuable information. But first, the magnitudes of the frequencies are plotted on the y-axis, and these are in decibels full scale. And the normalized frequencies are plotted on the x-axis, where 1 is the sampling frequency. We only plot till 0.5 because that's the Nyquist frequency, the highest representable frequency for a given sample rate. And the reason why I'm plotting the normalized frequencies here and not some specific range of frequencies like 0 to 24 kHz is that the frequency response of this filter is relative to the sample rate. So it would be the same for any sample rate. Looking at the plot, clearly what we've built here is a low-pass filter with a cutoff of negative 3 decibels at 0.25, which is half the Nyquist frequency. On the right is a phase response graph. The phase shifts of each of the frequencies are represented on this graph, where the y-axis represents the actual phase shift in degrees, and the x-axis is normalized frequency as before. So what we see is a straight line going from 0 degrees at 0 Hz to negative 90 degrees at the Nyquist. And this is said to be a linear phase response of the filter. As mentioned briefly in the previous videos, the linear phase response is a unique characteristic property of feedforward filters alone, and this can't be emulated in feedback filters, or analog filters for that matter. Phase response plots are generally hard to infer from, but we can see a general trend developing here. When you phase shift the two signals and add them together, you run the risk of canceling them out. At 0 Hz, there's zero phase shift, and there doesn't seem to be any attenuation. And as the phase shift increases, we can see that adding the two paths from the filter cause attenuation until it finally cancels out the signal towards the end. We also learned that the phase is linear only when the two coefficients are symmetric. So let's try putting in different values for the coefficients A0 and A1 and see what happens. I'll go with 0.75 and 0.25. Well, we get a general low-pass filter type, but the attenuation is not much here. It's only about negative 6 decibels. More importantly, the phase response is completely changed, and this is no longer a linear phase filter, since the coefficients are no longer symmetric about zero. I'm not even going to try and explain the shape of the phase response curve here, since I have no intuitive understanding of it either. Let's try one more set of coefficients. 0.5 and negative 0.5. This is quite interesting. With this set of coefficients, the filter has transformed itself into a high-pass filter for a change. Lower frequencies are attenuated, and higher frequencies are passed through. The phase response, as expected, is linear because the coefficients are symmetric. But it goes from a 90-degree phase shift at 0 Hz to 0-degree phase shift at the Nyquist. You can kind of figure out what's happening here. With a negative sign introduced within one of the filter coefficients, the signals from the two paths are being subtracted rather than being added. Now, if two signals are identical and are subtracted, they cancel each other out. Whereas if you introduce a phase shift in one of the signals, they don't cancel each other out. Let's take a look at an audio plugin that I've made with the feedforward filter design that we've been talking about. There are only two controls for this plugin. You can change the coefficients of A0 and A1 with these sliders. And I've also got the frequency and phase response plots here. The way I've implemented these responses are pretty much the same as how we've been generating them in Python, with an impulse response and its FFT. So whenever the coefficients change, I run an impulse signal through this filter and then perform the FFT on the output of the filter, which is basically performing an FFT on the impulse response. You can play around with this plugin yourself. You just need to get the code from GitHub and build it locally. The link to the repo is in the description. As you play around with this plugin, you can see a familiar response of a low-pass filter when both the coefficients are either positive or when both are negative. The phase response is only going to be linear if the two coefficients are symmetric. When one of the coefficients is negative and the other positive, we get a high-pass filter or a high-shelf filter instead. We can add white noise through this track and hear the filter in action. That's great. We've basically looked at a first-order FIR filter in detail. FIR filters are generally easy to understand, but filters with only two taps, like we've seen, is not very useful. And to get a more customized frequency response from our filter, we'll need several taps, sometimes hundreds. But the idea is incredibly simple. The coefficients of each of the taps represent the impulse response of the filter. So a non-mathematical approach of designing an FIR filter would be to first design the frequency response that you're looking for. Then perform an inverse FFT on it. This will basically convert the signal from the frequency domain to the time domain. The result would be an impulse response whose sample values can be mapped as coefficients of the filter. We can go over a couple of concrete and mathematical methods of efficiently designing FIR filters later on. But before that, let's take a look at the feedback topology and discover how fundamentally different they are from the feedforward filters that we've been talking about.